What am I saying?
This is MPW
the podcast with your host Xylo Aria.
Cool.
A podcast about music production
for the everyday musician,
where we learn from experienced studio engineers and each other.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to this episode of the MPW podcast. I'm your host, Xylo Aria, and today we are very lucky to be joined by Daniel Harmann. So Daniel is a songwriter and music producer and is also the director of acquisitions at DistroKid. So great to have you, Daniel.
Thank you so much for having me on. So happy to be here. I'm in the past and you're in the future.
Yes,
I'm in Seattle and you're in Australia, and it's a whole different day.
It is, actually. It is. Yeah, it's actually nice and early here, 8 o'clock, which is very early for me.
Oh, boy. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So it's kind of towards the end of your work day. How's it been for you today?
It's been a classic Monday, I'd say. It's always email mountain. I've tried to do less email on weekends and stuff so I can actually have a weekend and then wake up on Monday and just slowly open my computer and like cringe. But no, it's great. And it's 3 o'clock here. So in the afternoon, so it's almost done.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
And this is the highlight of my day. So
Lovely. Lovely. Yeah. Well, it's the highlight of ours too. So that's very good. That's very good. Yeah. So today we are talking about music distribution, which of course you have a lot of knowledge to share with us. That's really great. And I'm excited to get into it. But before we do that, I'd love to hear a bit more about your journey in music. And you were telling me an interesting story about how you ended up at DistroKid. So I'd love for you to share that with people and where you get started.
Sure. Yeah. Thank you for asking. I'm originally from Arizona and I moved to Seattle in 1999 and decided that I wanted to focus on making music. And so I recorded a few songs with a producer that I really liked named Greg Markle, and he decided to put the songs out as an EP. And I was like, oh, wow, you know, no one's ever really shown interest in what I've done before. Let's do it. And then I had to make a decision, like, am I going to focus on music or am I going to, you know, try to like still maybe be a photographer or paint or whatever? And I chose, well, I'm going to go full force into music. And so I did. And 20 years later, literally, I've got about 12 records out, like studio albums out, and some live stuff. And I've been on a couple labels and I've done some touring. And then it's all been fairly minor. A lot of self-release stuff. And then in 2015, I put out a record called White Mountains, and I'd heard about DistroKid and was like, oh, I'll give it a try. And I uploaded the album and there was a capitalization issue with one of my songs. And, you know, stores have or DSP streaming services all have a thing called standardized capitalization, which is where, you know, A's are supposed to be lower cases. And, you know, I had a song called The A in Adam, and DistroKid's upload form defaulted to the A being lowercase, and I wanted it to be uppercase. So I emailed support, which was actually just Philip, the founder, and he's like, and I was like, can this be fixed? And he said, no one's ever pointed that out to me before. I built this tool for you, and it allows you to choose, you know, your capitalization. I was like, that's amazing.
Wow.
You know, try getting anything done like that, even at McDonald's, let alone like a music distributor or music company. And I was just blown away. And I'm kind of a person that asks for things. I'm not afraid of being rejected. So I was like, if you ever need any help, let me know. I'd love to come work for you. And so he's like, I'll let you know. And then a year later, he posted about needing help and I raised my hand and we had a conversation and there I was. So I became the first employee at DistroKid in 2016. And started doing customer service and then migrated into doing other things. And now I kind of head up the marketing arm currently.
Wow. So that was 2016. That's actually not too long ago. It's surprising to me that it's kind of quite young in a way.
Yeah. So I think Philip started DistroKid, he'll kill me, like 2013, you know, is when it really, he built it. And he was doing another website that he kind of started DistroKid out of and then really started wanting people to use it. And I ended up hearing about it a couple of years later, 2015. Mm-hmm. And so 2016 it really kind of kicked off, I like to say, because I came on board. No, but yeah, so I was the first employee, and we were really small, two or three employees for the first couple years of me being here. And now we're, you know, I would say almost probably or just under 100, which is nuts.
Wow.
Oh. So a tremendous amount of growth in a short amount of time.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Oh, that's awesome. And yeah, I love the fact that you just kind of went out there and asked for what you wanted, because I think a lot of people, especially in music, are really scared to do that. And it's something that I've been trying to do myself in the last kind of 2 years, which I've never done before that. And even the amount of kind of people I've met and doors that I've opened for me have been incredible. So yeah, I'm a huge advocate. So that's amazing. Really cool.
Thank you. And I think that only having been, you know, in music and having to ask to get on bills or like play shows or go on tour, or work with certain people, that is what kind of prepared me to ask to work for DistroKid. Like just having to fight for yourself constantly.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was like a chicken egg situation kind of, you know, like, well, which came first? And I think really like, had I not been doing all of this prep and music, I wouldn't have been ready to come and ask to work at DistroKid and then be able to, you know, do stuff here.
Yeah. Yeah. No, cool. It's really good. And yeah, definitely. I'm sure people can get something from that even for their music. So that's really cool.
Don't be afraid, you know,
like,
especially
it.
Right now, people want to collaborate, you know, and people are hungry to collaborate. And so if there's someone famous that you want to work with, just shoot them an email, like be like, yeah, well, let me play on your song, or let me, you know, play guitar, sing on. People are open to that stuff now, especially because everyone's just like at home trying to stay sane.
Yeah, definitely. Oh, I love that. I hope so many people do that, because yeah.
Me too.
Yeah. really cool. So let's get into our topic today, which is music distribution. So yeah, usually we start our episode by defining our topic. So do you have a one sentence description or definition of what music distribution is?
I would say it's how you get your music off of your hard drive and into people's ears. Oh, that'd be
hard.
Yeah, because I think a lot of people, and I'm sure you experience this with clients, or they don't know what to do.
Yes.
They finish working with you and they're like, well, now what? Do I press CDs or whatever? And so a lot of people aren't familiar with the process. A lot of people think you just call Spotify and then they put your song in Spotify. That's not really how it works.
Yeah, I think that's so true, actually. And I still get quite a lot of questions saying, how do I get my music on Spotify? Where I think just because I've been doing that for quite a few years now, and I don't realize that for some people, that's still not common knowledge. So yeah, I think that's a good kind of one sentence to describe that. So yeah.
It's pretty amazing when people just don't know, and then you kind of have to take yourself out of it for a while and you go,
yes,
maybe there was a point then, you know, I had that same question. And it's totally fair, because if you're not in it constantly and it's like the first time you've done something,
exactly,
how would you know?
Exactly. Yeah, cool. So you get your music out to people through a music distributor. So that's great. Cool. So when you kind of look out for a distributor and you find someone, what do they actually do for you as a musician?
So I think there, you know, I can tell you what DistroKid will do for you. Some distributors offer other things like promotion, certain things like that. But for the most part, you want someone that will get your music, make it easy to upload your music, and then get it out to stores or DSPs quickly. Mm-hmm. And make it available. Ultimately, we're pushing files around on the internet, but there's a lot of behind the scenes stuff that happens, which is why DistroKid was able to be so small for so long. Our founder's a great programmer. And so he was able to, you know, utilize all these robots to do things that humans traditionally had done, you know, at other distributors. You know, you want someone that doesn't seem scammy, I guess, and it has good reviews. And honestly, it kind of just, it depends on what you want. Like DistroKid's perfect for pretty much everyone, but a lot of people that are attracted to us are folks that are putting out multiple songs. You know, a lot of YouTubers or cover artists are putting out songs like all the time. And a lot of the old model is paying per upload, which I used a different distributor before I came to CD Baby. I just said who it was. before I came over to DistroKid, and I was paying per upload, and that's, you know, $40 a pop. And so as an independent artist, that's a lot to recoup. And on top of that, they're also taking a percentage of your earnings. And so I guess it really is like, what's going to make the most sense for me? What's going to keep the most money in my pocket at the end of the day?
Yeah, cool. And when you, I mean, taking a step even back from that of when you're choosing a distributor, and you mentioned kind of look out for the scammy ones, but what kind of things do you need to consider when you're choosing a distributor?
When you're choosing a distributor, I think, you know, probably read, you know, reviews online, talk to your friends, go to shows, talk to the bands at shows, see who they like. Watch videos online about it. There's a lot of stuff on YouTube. And just figure out what works best for you as an artist. And then if you are putting out one song a day or multiple songs a year or whatever, figure out what's going to be the best financial choice for you. Are you going to be spending every time you upload, every time you log into the website, basically? And if that works for you, fine. But a lot of the time people are putting out so much content these days that it's just not practical anymore. People end up spending a lot of money that they don't need to.
And also, and I know this was something that I was told to kind of do a check on when I first was looking at distributors, and this was, I don't know, probably like 7-8 years ago. So I don't know if it's still a consideration, but do you need to kind of look at which channels they're kind of distributing to, or is it all pretty much the same these days?
Certainly. And, you know, I think most distributors out there are going to get you in the traditional stores like iTunes and Spotify and Google Play and YouTube. But you want to look for the ones that are doing the cool stuff. Like, we were the first distributor to get music into TikTok. We were the first distributor to, or one of the first to get your music into Instagram stories and on Facebook. So who's innovating? Who's doing the stuff that like the kids are looking out for? Because they're the ones that are consuming the content. And if that stuff's important to you, then you want to make your decision based on that, I think.
Cool. That's really cool, actually, because I mean, sometimes when you think of innovation, you in something that seems kind of simple in your brain of, you know, music distribution, sending your music to stores, it's hard to think how a company is being innovative. But that's a really good point because, yeah, I mean, TikTok is flourishing. I still have no idea what I'm doing on that, but it's massive. So it's really cool to know that. And that was something that you got on pretty early. So do you mean like when you look for a 15-second song, your one will come up? Is that what you mean on TikTok?
Yeah. So, or if you are doing a post, you search, if you want to add music to it, you can search for like a song and that'll be like the loop. And the distributor works with the artist to determine what portion of the song is going to be used.
Right.
You know, so okay. We don't send the entire thing. We send a snippet of the song to TikTok, for example, and you get to choose what that part is. Like, if you want it to be like the hooky chorus, you know, and then you become the next Lil Nas X, that's definitely possible.
Yeah.
So you can choose that on the upload form, like what chunk you want to send off.
Oh, very interesting. I didn't know that. And that's really useful as well. So yeah, cool.
Puts the power in the artist's hands.
Yeah. I mean, I've used a few different distributors before and I haven't come across that function yet. So that's really cool. It's really cool. So when you have a track, so you've just finished recording, mixing, mastering this amazing, incredible track, what do you then have to do? And you've got your distributor, you know, what do you need to then get this track into the store?
So I always recommend, you know, having it mastered. You know, I know that seems simple, but a lot of times people will release singles that aren't mastered because it's not up against another song necessarily, and like on an EP or on an album. So I think getting it mastered, making it sound as good as possible, having cool artwork,
yeah.
And then having a story ready, because part of what you can do now is pitch it to playlist curators on Spotify as soon as you're done uploading it. So have kind of a roadmap for promotion. You know, if you're just going to put out a song and not care about it, that's one thing. But if you're like, I'm going to talk about this, I'm going to promote it as much as I can on my own, you want to have that ready to go for when it's actually out. And a thing that we do is called hyperfollow, which is some products out there that are similar, but basically as soon as you upload your song, you get a hyperfollow link, which you can then share on social media. That link never changes, and it allows people to pre-save your release on Spotify, and then you also get their email address. So if you want to add them to your, you know, your email blast or whatever, right, that option is there.
Yeah.
And then once it's actually out, that page auto-populates automatically with all the other stores' links to that release. You can also edit it. You can add your Bandcamp. You can add videos to it. So really utilizing the tools that are free,
yeah,
and available for you to use to promote a thing without having to spend a ton of money.
Yeah. Cool.
And give yourself time.
Yeah.
I think just give yourself time. We pride ourselves on being quick at getting stuff out there quickly, into stores quickly, but to really market a release and get it ready and pitch it to playlist curators and get your audience familiar with it and pass along snippets and little videos and stuff, I think that takes time. And you know, I always allow myself about a month.
Yeah.
When I release a single, because you never know. Also, like, there could be something wrong with the artwork and you may need to swap that out or something. So things happen.
Mm-hmm.
So give yourself time.
Yeah, no, that's really good. So then I guess that summarizes is your mastered track, hopefully, and your album artwork and time and all the kind of assets you need for a release strategy and that kind of thing. So yeah, really cool. And I really like the hyperlink thing actually, because I mean, and that sounds like another form of innovation in a way. And because these days, especially with Instagram, you have one link to kind of win people, and increasing your mailing list is a hugely important thing these days. And I know that can be tricky for a lot of people. So it's really cool that you have that all in the one spot.
Thank you. I think it's important. And I think, and I've had to do it a million times in the past too, is, you know, hey, if you listen on YouTube, here's the link. If you listen on Spotify, here's the link. But that gets exhausting for you as a creator, but also for the people to have to see that don't listen on that service. So having a one-stop shop, I think, is just so valuable.
Yeah.
Because you can put it anywhere. It never changes. That link never changes. The URL, but you can change the content on
it.
So
yeah.
I think it's super important and it's free.
Yeah. Really cool. So, I mean, going back to release strategy, you were saying kind of having a month lead up and that kind of thing. Do you have any specific tips on promoting your music or kind of for creating that release strategy?
I would just have it all ready to roll before you upload. DistroKid can help you get your Spotify artist page verified as soon as you upload. So once that happens and you have a verified page, you have access to Spotify for Artists, and then you can pitch directly through their platform to content to playlist curators, which is the name of the game these days.
Yeah.
Honestly, mm-hmm. Playlisting. And so, you know, my band, I play in a punk rock band called Local Liars, and we had a record come out about 2 years ago, and we had all done stuff locally and toured individually, but we were kind of like, for lack of a better term, this like Seattle, like punk rock, like super group, you know? So we had an interesting story.
Mm-hmm.
And when the record came out, we released two singles beforehand and then the full length. And each of those singles before the full release came out, we pitched to Spotify, and one of them ended up getting on a Spotify punk playlist.
Wow.
So, and we had never done anything before. So other than having the story of what we had done previously, and that may not have even mattered. You know, the curators may have just enjoyed our bio. They certainly, you know, it sounds like they enjoyed the song and they chose to put it on a playlist, and that's huge.
Yeah.
Especially for a new artist. So, have your ducks in a row when you upload, and just be ready to tell your story.
Mm-hmm.
That would be my advice on that.
Yeah. And do you, when you say tell your story, do you mean like in a press release, or what, or where should you put that?
It really depends, I think, on what you want to do. Back in the day, I used to do a ton of my own, like, you know, what are the one sheets?
Yeah.
With the, like, here's the top songs off the album, and here's the artwork, and here's some previous, you know, quotes and stuff. I'm sure that's fine still. And, you know, if you're planning on touring, you know, once coronavirus is over, that's important to send to bookers. But I think really working on building your online presence, working on, you know, promoting your If you want to focus on Spotify, work on promoting your Spotify page. If you want to focus on YouTube, there's not one easy answer anymore.
Right.
There's a lot of different things out there that you have to work in. But it's also great because there's a lot of options. Like if you don't want to care about YouTube, your YouTube numbers, you don't have to. If you don't want to worry about Spotify, you don't have to. So figure out what's going to be the most important to you. What's most valuable? If you have to spend money, what's the most valuable spend? Mm-hmm. And then figure out and just go from there.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it kind of talks about the main aspects, which is just being prepared, I guess, for the release rather than leaving. I mean, there is enough left to chance, I guess, to not leave anymore on your end. So just getting as prepared as possible. That's, sounds good. So another question that, I mean, gets asked sometimes is, do distributors do any promotion on their end?
So I'm really bad. I try not to pay attention, a lot of attention to what other distributors are doing.
Yeah, yeah.
So I can't really say, you know, this one offers this or this one offers this. I'm sure there are some, but I'm also pretty sure that those are services that you have to pay for. So I would, if you're choosing a distributor, choose the ones that offer the free tools, you know, the Hyperfollow link, the Spotify for Artist Verification, things like that. And those are all going to work in your favor. They're free. They're things that everyone needs. And then you just figure out, like we'd chatted about before, like, what's important to you and lean into it. Use the free tools, ask your friends to put your song in their Instagram story, mm-hmm. stuff like that. You know, use your network and honestly, like work your email list.
Yeah.
I'm turning into a bit of a Luddite because I'm like, I don't have any social media. I've been slowly peeling it back for the last several years.
No.
And so like, I don't have a Twitter anymore. My Instagram is dead and I'm soon to shut down my Facebook band page because it's just like one other thing, you know? So I'm going to drive all of my traffic to my new website and then that's going to be it. And then I'm going to work on building my email list mm-hmm. and send, you know, quarterly emails or if something new comes out or something big happens, do that. But that's me.
Yeah.
That's
yeah,
not
yeah.
the majority of people, but that's the thing that works for me. And it's going to cause me the least amount of stress and the most amount of joy, I think.
Yeah.
So figure out what you want to do.
Yeah. I mean, that's the ultimate dream, isn't it? That I mean, you do all the social media stuff in order to get people into your closer circle. So if people are already on your emailing list and that kind of thing, and you can get away from doing the social stuff, that sounds like a dream to me because, yeah, it does get a lot to manage.
Yeah. I think the thing that was always the most frustrating for me. And I was like, and once someone figures this out, they're going to be considered a genius. But it was like show management. Because if I was like going on tour or even playing a handful of shows or even one show, there were like 10 different places that I had to post it, you know, on my website, on Facebook, on Songkick or whatever, who then aggregated out to other places. But it was just that was exhausting. And that is one small piece of it. So if you can figure out how to cut the noise and do what's important to you, I think that's where you win.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh my gosh. Yeah. It's so true. It's so true. Maybe that's the next, another business idea that you can work on, Daniel.
It's a freebie. I threw that one out there.
Yep, someone grab it and run with it.
Yeah.
No, really cool. So actually we had an episode very recently on legal splits and song splits between artists, between producers, whatever that is. And I think people, hopefully after they hear that episode, understand in theory what that means. But then once you work that out, how do you actually, you know, put that in place in your distribution? Is that fairly easy to do?
It's super easy with DistroKid. We came up with this product, I think it's about 3 years now, called Teams. And we were the first distributor to offer splits. And I think there's a few others that do it now. But basically, you just have to have a DistroKid account. So let's say you and I collaborate on something and I agree to pay you 50, give you 50% of all of my earnings, you know, or 10% or 1% or whatever. I upload and then I invite you to my team. I designate the amount and then you get an email saying, you know, Daniel G. Harmann invited you to his team. and you either, and then if you have an account, you log in and you put a code in. But if you don't have an account, you get a chance to get 50% off, not a chance, but you get a code to get 50% off your first year's membership. So our memberships start at $20 a year. So that's a $10 thing.
Yeah. Right.
So for me, that's a kind of a no-brainer, you know, because that also promotes collaboration, because if you're paying to have a DistroKid account, but you're not putting out other stuff, you know, you can talk about collaborating with other people, and then it's just super easy to get paid for that. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure how other distributors do it, but it's super easy. You know, my band, basically our drummer uploads everything and then just invites us to the team. We split everything evenly. And so it just goes straight to my bank.
Yeah.
And straight to the drummer's bank and straight to the other guitar player's bank.
Oh, nice.
It's super easy. And you just see like 0.25 of team for the song scenario. And then it's just right there. And you don't have to worry about it. And you don't have to like track your bass player down to write him a 25-cent check. Mm. You know?
Checks. Well, yeah, that's really going old school.
Yeah, I know. But it's super easy now.
Yeah.
So it's a yet another free tool that you have at your disposal. It's like the value of having an accountant for next to nothing.
Yeah, yeah, no, that's really cool. And so we were talking about the different platforms that your music goes out to. You know, it's really hard to kind of think about which one to focus on. And some people have asked, I kind of want to focus on whichever one generates the most money. So do you have any thoughts on which platform pays the most, like per play or something like that?
Not really. All I can really say is that, you know, we, DistroKid, collects the money that the stores and DSPs send to us, and then we just give you 100% of it and it goes straight into your bank. The rates are very complicated based on region, subscriber level. Like if you're
really,
yeah, I believe like if you are a free user on Spotify, that may pay out less than a paid user pays.
Right.
Spotify actually has a really great video that you can watch that explains that. Mm-hmm. I need a refresher on it myself. I'll send that to you if you want to post it in this. But basically, you know, you might need to Google around and check different FAQs for different stores. But I think this kind of basic thing is if it's a paid thing like iTunes or Google Play, you will keep more because that's a like an actual thing that is saved.
Right. Yeah.
Versus a stream. But I think one thing that like gets lost a lot of the time, you know, especially with a lot of old schoolers like me, for example, who are like, artists aren't making money anymore. It's like, well, A, most of them never did, but B, you would buy a CD at a show. And that's a one-time $10 for that artist. Now, you're continuing to make money forever. Even if, you know, the song is out for 10 years, you're making money for 10 years. And let's say it gets, you know, you get picked up and you're licensed on a television show or something. You know, you never know what's going to happen in your lifetime of music. So I think it's a very exciting time for artists, especially when it comes to, you know, potentially making and earning. And it's, I think there's more opportunity now than there was, you know, 15, 20 years ago, or even 10 years ago when you were relying on, for example, even downloads. iTunes, again, just a one-time purchase, but a stream is like every time you listen, every time someone listens, you're making money. And yes, it's nominal, but it adds up over time. So I think that's something that people, you know, kind of forget. It's important to remember.
Yeah, definitely. I think that's such a good point. And I think it's a thing that comes with change, you know, going from the old school way of CD distribution and that kind of thing to online streaming. It was just such a massive change, and where, you know, it was unsolicited for a long time and music just being stolen really for a period. Maybe a lot of people just didn't know how to adapt to that and then kind of went with that thought, I'm thinking, of like, it's hard to make money. But with everything, I think change comes with opportunity. Yeah.
So, and change is scary. And I, you know, my wife will be the first to tell you that I suck at change. So I'm right there with everybody. You know, especially when it's your passion, it's your art, you know, that you want to make sure that you're getting what you deserve. And, you know, I truly believe, you know, that DistroKid allows that to happen because we give you everything that you are making from the stores. We give straight to you and we're not taking a cut out of it. So That's my pitch.
That does sound like your pitch.
It's just about having conversations, you know?
Cool. And so one thing we kind of touched on before about the importance of playlisting, which seems to be kind of the word of the last few years. Do you have any advice on that? I mean, I know you mentioned when you become a verified artist, you can kind of pitch to playlists through Spotify, but are there any other things outside of that that you can do to increase your chances of that?
Spotify actually just released I think it was last week, a great blog post about playlisting, how their curated playlists work, how pitching works, and kind of the science behind it, and actually the human touch that goes into it, and how their curators really do listen to everything. But I think that, you know, I think I briefly mentioned it, like, I think it's really important to have a story. And if you don't have, like, if you've never toured or you've never had a song on, you know, ABC or whatever, like, I'm not saying make it up, but elaborate a little bit on what you have done or what this song means to you or what inspired you to write it. Because I think that those things really resonate with people, especially curated, you know, playlist curators, yeah. The ones that are making those decisions. And I just really think I used to get really frustrated because I used to run our album review department. So I was looking at stuff all the time and I was like, I just sometimes wish more people tried harder at making good artwork, something that stands out, you know, catch people's eye. Because that was just a selfish thing for me and maybe slightly judgmental, but I always, when I'm putting out records, like that is so important. That's almost as important as the song is.
Yeah.
You know, especially when we are doing like CDs or vinyl or whatever, you know, the artwork is so important. And especially now you just get, you know, 3,000 by 3,000 instead of, you know, basically a foot wide to do stuff. So try to make it as exciting as you can, mate. Try to make it pop and catch people's eyes. And I think a combination between that, having good music and having a story, those are the tips that I can give you for that, for playlist consideration. But I'm not a curator, but those are just the things that I've kind of caught on over the years, I guess.
And I think a few artists can kind of fall into that trap of, I can't be bothered doing this or putting that much effort into it, which is a bit of a waste, I guess, when you've spent so much time and energy in creating this music that you love. It's kind of not really giving it the best chance by not putting that bit extra for the artwork and everything. So I think that makes sense. So
it might sound cold, but like if you can't be bothered to put your best product out there, why would someone else be bothered to pay any attention to it?
I think that's just hard, cold truth, isn't it? Which, yeah.
I think so, which we're kind of used to in this industry. You know?
I mean, the quicker we do that, I think it's better for ourselves. So, yeah, that's good. So one thing actually, which again, we talked about in our episode with a music lawyer, Bindu, was cover songs. So what she was saying that is kind of, legally, how people just put music up on YouTube and everything, like covers, it's not really legal. So, I noticed that at DistroKid you can distribute cover songs. So, how does that work?
You know, I don't know all the legal stuff behind it, but I do know that, you know, we acquire the cover license for you through our partner, Harry Fox Agency, very well known and highly established agency. So basically you upload your cover song and you agree that it's $12 a year per song, so $1 a month, and that's just to maintain the cover license. And then we ship the song over to them, and they check it out and they make sure it's all good, and then they send us a yes or a no. Generally it's a yes, and then all of the, you know, royalties are paid to the original songwriter as they should be, and and then you also get your portion distributed into your DistroKid bank. And that's the kind of short end of it. And again, I'm not a lawyer. I have there's a lot about music law that is beyond me.
Me too.
And probably most people, frankly. But that's it. That's what I've got.
Yeah. No, cool. I mean, that makes it quite easy because Bindu was saying, you know, ideally you would talk to your publishing rights authority in your country and get them to do that for you, which I guess is good, but this is a lot easier. So that's handy to know.
It used to be really tricky too and complicated. You know, you used to have to pay a lot of money, like even in the late 90s, just to get a song approved to cover. And I remember I covered a song by this like really popular song in the 90s. And it was before I was using DistroKid, and I wanted to just like upload it to Bandcamp, and I had to actually get permission from the band.
Yeah. Yeah.
To do it. And luckily I knew a dude that knew a dude in the band. And so he was like, yeah, sure, whatever. This is the least of our problems. Yeah. But these are it's very different now. You know, it's all taken care of for you as long as you're doing it the right way. But yeah, people upload covers and stuff to YouTube, and I don't necessarily think those are legal, like just uploading them directly.
Apparently completely not.
Yeah. So, but you can get your cover songs on YouTube and everywhere else if you go through a distributor.
Yeah, cool.
Like DistroKid.
Yeah, cool. No, good to know. And yeah, that makes the process a lot easier. So if you wanted to kind of, you know, if you really like the sound of DistroKid, for example, and you were currently using other platforms, is there a way to kind of move your catalog over, or do you recommend just kind of adding new releases to the new platform, or how would that work?
Oh, you can absolutely, it's not like a transfer my music over button, but you can absolutely upload old releases. We have a lot of legacy, well-known legacy artists that are released from their contracts that upload and that use DistroKid for their distribution needs now. One of my favorite punk rock bands of all time, Propaganda, uses us because they were released from, you know, contract years ago. So yes, there's absolutely ways to do it. We have FAQs that explain the entire process.
Right.
It's super simple. You know, the gist is that you just upload through DistroKid, wait for it to appear in the store, and then pull it down from your other distributor.
Right.
There's some details in there too about like if you want to try to retain your play counts or stay on playlists and stuff, there's things that you have to do. But yep, super easy and totally legal.
Yeah, cool. No, good to know. Good to know. So thank you. I think that's been a really good, rounded chat about distribution for me anyway. I think that would have been really useful when I was first looking for a distributor. Before we finish it off, I have a couple of questions from our audience for you. So the first one is from Sherelle Wyman. So Sherelle asks, would you recommend having a following before putting music out there for sale?
Hi, Sherelle. No, I think that, you know, getting your music out there helps create your following. And, you know, it's so easy now. It's so inexpensive. You know, people oftentimes are like, well, should I, because our upload form defaults to like every store, right? And store is just kind of my old school way of saying like all the places. And I say, yes, do it. Like get your stuff everywhere possible.
Yeah.
Because you never know, like maybe someone uses Angami exclusively. Maybe someone uses, you know, only consumes music on YouTube. So the more places you get it out there, the more chance you have of being heard. And if it's your first release, that's awesome. Be stoked about it. You know, don't feel like you have to like play a million shows to be able just to put a song out. Those things go hand in hand. Especially now, you can play a show and be like, hey, here's a card with my Spotify link, or, you know, I'll send you an email with my Spotify link, or the song is on Spotify. Just look up my name. Those things, they're partners, you know, they're not separate. So absolutely not. I don't think you need to have a following before just getting your music out there.
Cool. No, sounds good. Sounds good. And then we have another question from Sam Warren. So Sam from London, she asks, would you recommend using an extra short edit for Spotify, as she's heard that some people do this to stop people from skipping the track and then forfeiting the stream income that you get?
Hi, Sam. Great question. Simple answer. Absolutely not. Stores don't allow it.
Oh, okay. So, interesting.
You have to upload the full version. Stores don't allow tests or snippets or previews or anything like that. Some get through, you know, some distributors, you know, allow it or aren't familiar with the rules or whatever. We are very strict, and we're strict because stores are strict.
Yeah.
We are beholden to the stores, ultimately. If we don't have a good relationship with the stores, you don't have a good relationship with DistroKid, you know? Like, so the easy answer is no, don't do that. Now, if you want to promote it on TikTok or something, like we had chatted about before, you can choose the snippet, the portion of the song that you want. That's totally fine. But you have to upload the full version.
Yeah, cool. So, all right. Well, thank you so much for that, Daniel. I think that was really useful, and I'm sure something a lot of people who haven't got their music up on Spotify yet will learn a lot from, and people that have as well will learn a few new things that are out there as well. So thank you so much. And before I close off, DistroKid have been really great to provide all our listeners with 30% off their first year of DistroKid membership. So I mean, $19-ish dollars is pretty good anyway, but 30% off that is even better. So yeah, you can find that at distrokid.com/VIP/MPW. I'll put the link in the podcast anyway for anyone that's interested. So yes, that's a huge thank you for setting that up. And yeah, it's been lovely chatting to you, Daniel. Do you have much else on today?
I have two dogs that I need to walk around the block. And I'm in Seattle, Washington, which I'm not sure if you are familiar, is never sunny.
Oh, but, I think I've heard of
that. But it's sunny here right now. So I'm going to enjoy some sunshine. And, the wonderful thing about summers here is that it ends up being, light out until like 9 or 10
p.m.
So enjoying the light and the warmth as much as I can until we go into an 8-month lockdown.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah.
of gloom.
All right. So. Well, I better not keep you from that small window of sunshine. Oh. So, been lovely chatting to you, Daniel, and enjoy the rest of your day.
You too. Thank you. Enjoy the full day ahead of you.
Thanks.
Thanks so much.